Hey, what's up everybody? It's Brian here. This time we're going to do a walkthrough of my Cut of Giants. We're going to do it in Premiere, so let's get going. Giants is a video that is up on my channel right now. You can check it. I'm linking it in the description. There's also a card right now up in the right hand corner. It's a nice short little montage I edited right after the retreat I took recently. And one thing that was requested of me shortly thereafter was break it down. Like, how did I actually do it? It's actually one of my more simple cuts. I think it's a perfect cut to break down. So before I do anything else, let's watch it together. Alright, so here we are, we're in the cut right now. As you guys can see, I used quite a bit of sound design, but it's not as much as I usually do. I only really did like 4 or 5 tracks of varying sound design, but I did use 4 stems from a track. The track I used for this one is Stay Near by Luix. You can find it on Epidemic Sound. Cannot recommend it anymore. Check them out. It is built for YouTube creators. They have sound effects and music tracks that are royalty free. Once you link your YouTube account with them, you're good to go. I'm also linking in the description a referral code. Click on that so you can sign up today. If you sign up with my referral code, I get a free month, and then you're able to do the same and share it with your friends and get free months as well. So definitely check it out. If you are interested in getting content creation, or if you are an artist like me who needs music, this is the route to go. All right, so yeah, this is the stems. I like to work in stems. That way I can modify. Maybe I bring in more low end when I need it, or take the low end out when I need it. I didn't really do too much of that here in this cut. But let's take a look. The goal here was just, I shot a whole bunch of cool footage when we were on retreat. Didn't really have any purpose in mind. I just shot. And when we got home, I was like, I gotta do something cool with this. This is gonna be fun. I used 2 primary cameras for this piece. And one of them is my Canon Rebel SL3. With a 24-70 millimeter Sigma lens. It's an REF lens with some filters. So I used an ND filter so that I was shooting outside, so that way I would still get my depth of field. Even though it was pretty foggy and cloudy, I still needed the ND filter because I wanted depth of field where I could get it. And then the other camera actually uses a drone. It is my DJI Mavic Air 2. Plenty of footage I've been using for like the last couple of weeks on my channel. Definitely check out some of my other videos. I actually color grade this first shot right here in DaVinci in a different way actually than what I color graded here. I actually like the color grade in my tutorial a lot better than this one, so I definitely recommend checking that one out as well. But yeah, so basically the story I wanted to tell is the journey that we have going into the Sequoia National Park. The trees there, I mean, they're gigantic trees. That's why I decided to call this Giants. And yeah, this just catalogs our journey hiking through the park, going to General and Sherman. So to get started, obviously, I wanted to get the highway, the road that we would use to get there, and that's what I did. And I thought this was a really good establishing shot for this, and so I used it. And then I kind of threw this shot in here just because I wanted it to be known where we started. Like, we started out in the valley before we even climbed the mountain. But I didn't want to spend too much time on the journey itself. I wanted to spend more time about the national park, so... one thing you guys will also notice is this is really the first part where the sound design kicks in. If I solo this, you'll hear it right off the bat. You don't really hear it when it's in the mix, but it is there. It's in the very low frequencies as well too. And I pretty much EQ'd this so that it's in my high frequencies with the buzz and in the low frequencies too with a rumble. So it kind of just fills out some air that I needed to fill out. And that's just some basic drone Foley that I got. Obviously as well, you're going to hear this, these tracks right here. Hindsight 2020, I actually should have came back here and actually added more reverb and fall off with maybe a delay, so that it just falls off nice and quiet. I remember thinking about it and I just ended up not doing it, but that's, I just added a breath there. I wanted it to feel like you're coming up for a breath of fresh air. Especially for us who went on this retreat, we live in the city. So when we went out to the valley and then get ready to go Sequoia, this is definitely fresh air for us. So I wanted to make sure I had at least one of those elements in here where it's like us just, you know, just relaxing, taking a breath. So that's why I added it there. It's a little aggressive right now in the cut. I think in the final cut, I might have actually relaxed that. I'm not sure. And the way I would relax it is it's obviously in a high frequency, high, mids to high. So I just use an EQ curve and I would pull it out on the master. One other thing to note as well too, guys. All of my video here is complete sound design. So there's probably rumble audio in this SL3 footage. This is SL3 footage, but I strip it. I only add the video and then I just completely sound design. If I'm editing something with dialogue, I'll keep the dialogue, of course, but that's usually recorded on a separate device. I very rarely do I record in camera dialogue or audio. And I just add it and I sound design it. Of course, I haven't released any of those tutorials yet on my channel. Those are coming soon, by the way, where I go over how I handle audio and video separately. I sync them in. Sometimes I sync manually, sometimes I sync auto. I'll cover that in a video here probably next week. But all of my audio here is sound design. The rumble that you're hearing from the road is just an EQ'd out jet engine, I think. Like, I EQ'd out the jet engine recorded from inside of a plane. So I get creative with your audio. That's something I always tell people, and audio is always going to push your edits over the edge. If you're a VFX artist and you're watching this and you're like, this doesn't really pertain to me, well, when you're cutting your reel, you can do little tricks like this too that really just push your comps over the edge if you're using custom work. Obviously, if you're doing, if you're a professional already in the industry and you're putting stuff on your reel from like things that you worked on, you're not going to be putting audio. You're usually just going to be putting the actual shot to focus in on. But obviously, if you're a starting filmmaker, you're a budding VFX artist, this is a good habit to get into because it's also going to help you. One thing I haven't even shown you guys yet, there's an actual trick I use to get my audio and my cuts too. Obviously, with the drum track down here on the stems, I can hear the beats. You know, I can see the beats. I can also watch the beats in my instrumental track, and you know, you can even listen to it if you, you know, if you're used to the song. So it's a good song, but I actually, believe it or not, will bring in my beats track. This is a beats per minute that I recorded at the beats per minute for this track. It's muted right now because I don't have it in the final cut, but let's solo it real quick so you guys can see it. So that's actually how I cut, by the way. I usually, especially if I'm cutting B-roll into, you know, a documentary or a short film I'm working on, I'll use the music track that I'm gonna pad the B-roll with a BPM when I'm editing. I'll have it, and then I'll usually delete it. And not everybody does it. I think it's a trick that I just enjoy doing. I think it helps, and you'll notice all my cuts are on a beat. And the pacing changes too. I also use it for pacing. I know that this is, I believe, I don't have it in front of me, so I could double click this and find out because I name them all. This is 74 beats per minute. And so I believe that, you know, obviously right here I'm cutting on fours, but at the beginning I don't. Like I cut through several beats. I let it relax. It's my establishing shot. I want to breathe, like holding a breath, and then I come up. And so my pacing with my video and my sound design as well is very particular. So you'll notice my sound design also hits on the beats, right? Let's watch that same segment real quick, this time with the beats track on. Hard to tell, but there's sound changes as well too. So right here, I EQ'd my rumbles differently than I EQ'd the first one because my position in the car changed when I was filming and I wanted to capture that. This has a little bit more high end right here, where this has more low end. And I wanted that so that you get the sense that things are changing. Not necessarily changing where I am, but the story is changing, it's progressing. So yeah, so everything I do, I try to keep it organic as it grows through, but I also want it just to be like almost subconscious. I don't want you to notice these things, and that's the VFX artist in me. I want these to like pretty much fly over your head and not realize what's going on, and that's kind of the VFX artist in me. You know, if you noticed what I'm doing, I feel like I've failed as an artist. My goal as a VFX artist is to trick your brain into thinking everything is real, and I do that with my editing too, so... But anyway, so yeah, I just wanted to cover that real quick with the sound design. Let's keep going forward. Yeah, so this, whenever you see on my timeline where it says MVI, it's more than likely my DSLR footage, which comes in as video. Unfortunately, I don't have CineStyle. I don't have flat codecs there. So I had to get really creative with how I handled my footage, whereas DGI is flat. And you can just see the difference. This just looks so much better than this one. I mean, it looks good, but it just looks so much better. Another thing, too, is this footage here is 60 frames a second, whereas this is 24. And that plays here actually in the next couple of shots on how that helps me out. So we come through. This is just pure brutal. You hear this little rumble transition. I like to use that a lot. Sometimes I overuse it. I think I kind of overused it here. But there's this rumble transition. Things like that, I kind of want to stand out, right? Like, I don't mind if you noticed that. I want you to feel the transition. It's not perfect, but it's a good trick to get into. It's a good trick to get into, but it's also a good trick not to abuse. You don't want to overuse that maybe once or twice a video, or if you're doing like a full short film, once during your B-roll sequence, you know, things like that. One thing to note, this is all handheld footage, so it does get shaky at times. Did not use my gimbal here, but I felt pretty good with some of the stabilization. I didn't really use too much stabilization in Premiere, but I do feel pretty good. Like, my hands did a pretty good job, especially considering how cold it was there. You know, I'm a SoCal native, so we walked out there, I was in the 40s. Yeah, it was cold, and I didn't bring my jacket. Yeah, you can see right there, it's a little bit shaky, but I kind of use that to my advantage. You know, I hear a lot of filmmakers out there, they'll see like shaky footage and then they'll try and stabilize and they're not able to. And when they're not able to, they throw the footage out and they kick themselves. But I'm like, use it. Use it in its own way. If you can use everything creatively, it'll just help you. So one thing I also see in a lot of mistakes in, especially demo reels for VFX artists and my reels, I used to do this all the time, is when you're telling a joke, the awkward silence makes the joke better, usually. Same thing goes for editing and video. We need to breathe as an audience when we're watching it. And so I'm pretty particular with the music tracks that I'll use. It's why I like Epidemic Sound. And I love tracks that give you a break. There's a lot of tracks on Epidemic Sound too, but elsewhere where like it's just like a rock song all the way through. They're hammering it all the way through. I don't like using tracks like that unless I need to. I like it to where when a song comes to a stop and lets our brains just digest what's happening. It also, notice, makes this part right here, which isn't very punchy, punch. Also, this is the only still image I used. So here's an example of why I like using the 60 frames per second on my camera, even though it can shoot as low as 30. It technically can shoot 24 if I shot 4K, but I just didn't do it. I wanted 60 frames. So what I did here, I slowed this footage down to 40%. You'll notice in my one of my tutorials I just released on my channel, it's part two, it's the keyframing tutorial. I do a trick like this. I do it with keyframes, but I actually slow my footage down to 40% of what 60 frames is. It's close to 24, it's not quite, but because I shot at a high shutter speed, I'm able to slow my footage down. There's enough information there for the computer to use to stitch it together, and I get this nice slow motion effect. And notice I only do it for a few shots. I don't always use it because if you keep using the same trick, it gets boring. So I got to this point, I realized that this needed to be a montage. I had no dialogue, there was no real vocal story behind this. So you'll notice that I started pulling the sound design a little bit back once we get into the meat of this video. That is very intentional. I had a lot of sound design here. But I decided to pull a lot of it back because I wanted us just to go into the video. And I didn't want you to notice that the sound design was out. And so you'll notice break. I use the music track at this point. This is a crescendo of the song that I use. So I wanted that to carry the video forward. Crescendo is ending, and so now my birds come back. I just thought this clip was funny, so I threw it in. But this is, I actually shot this when we were entering, but I wanted to use it as we're leaving the park. I don't know why, I thought it was hilarious in my mind. There's another pause, it's another beat. I actually paused for a full beat, four beats. Notice the first clip is slow-mo, so I didn't do any sound design, but also following the same this is another crescendo of the song. I wanted that to punch, and I wanted it to be the focus of this without you realizing it, so. And then we bring the rumble back because now I'm playing a video in real time. And then I have another, I have more slow motion shots, and then I don't bring the rumble back. And then now I'm in the air with the drone again, so I bring my air effects back. So I wanted this to jar. I needed something to change your viewpoint here. You know, we've returned to the house. This is my pastor, Eric. He's a good friend of mine. And I needed a change here because this is a different shot from everything that I put around it. You know, you have the what looks like smoke, honestly, in the background. It's not smoke. It's just foggy. One other thing, too, is without realizing we're in natural elements, we're out in the San Joaquin Valley. You know, there's not really cicadas, but like, you know, you hear the wildlife, you hear the insects, and there's a lot of insects out there. And so I wanted to actually have at least one clip with that. And so I use this clip, and then I realize I do need to have that sound. I bring it back a couple times too. This is the first time I introduce it. I'm just using EQ curves to pull, push, pull, push. That's pretty much it, guys. That's how I did Giants. It's pretty straightforward. It's simple. That's why I wanted to do it. A lot of my cuts can get really complex, especially if I'm doing something with dialogue content. You know, I'm doing something speaking. I can, you know, usually I'll have like 4 tracks of dialogue, you know, 4 tracks for music, and then like 10 plus tracks for just sound effects, and then submix tracks. And then video tracks can get pretty insane too as well. You'll notice I only use I think at most 3. I think I have the title on the third on its own track here. I didn't even put a watermark on this one. I should have, honestly, but I didn't. But yeah, I mean that's pretty much the basics of how I edit in Premiere. I wanted to share this because I've done 2 tutorials so far that have been released, but nothing's been finished, like a full cut that you guys can see. I try to keep everything simple. I don't like to overcomplicate things. I try to get as much done so that you can believe it's real so that I can keep going forward. But every now and then I'll go in super deep. So if you like this video, guys, definitely let me know in the comments below. Be sure to like as well as subscribe to the channel and hit that bell icon so you know when more videos go live. I have a lot more Premiere tutorials. I actually have an entire series of After Effects getting ready to go live as well too. Being a VFX artist, it would be almost sacrilegious not to have an After Effects library on my channel. So definitely check all that out. I'm going to leave some links to videos here in the ending, and I'll see you in the next video.